Raise your hand, and Petra Schnack is also here, so you can approach us for questions. But for now, I'd like to hand over to our experts. We're going to start with the environmental side. We have Christos Chrysakis. Come over, Christos.
He's an expert for alternative fuels and emissions. And then he will be later joined by Stine Mundal. She's head of environmental certification. And they will introduce you to the global sulfur cap and the greenhouse gas reduction, the balancing act, alternative fuels, and also touch upon scrubbers. So.
Thank you very much, Nikos. So we'll talk about maybe one of the hottest questions in shipping today, the global sulfur cap. And as if this is not challenging enough, we'll combine the discussion with the recently agreed IMO greenhouse gas reduction strategy. So the way we see it is this is really a balancing act. And why do I say this? On one hand, we have the global sulfur cap. We know this very well. Short-term impact. We all know that the fuel cost is going to go up. It's very hard to say how much is going to be the price of fuel, but for sure we know it's going to go up. And there are some technologies for actually allowing you to reduce your fuel costs, but these are technologies like LNG, for example, or scrubbers or other alternative fuels, so that include a quite significant capital investment. So it's not very straightforward, what is the best solution? We very often get this question, what is the best solution for the global sulfur cap? And there is not a single answer, there's not a silver bullet. Depending on your ship type, operations, many other parameters, there will be a different solution for different types of ships. And while you have to consider all that and take a decision very quickly if you have not taken a decision already, at the same time, we have the greenhouse gas reduction strategy that was recently agreed at the IMO. This is going to have a long-term impact.
Can I take this mic? You need to use this one.
Okay, sorry. Then I have to probably
can
stand
you do it from here.
Yeah, I can do it from here. Okay. Sorry. Then we have the we know that there is going to be long-term impact for the from the greenhouse gas reduction targets, but we don't know yet how this is going to be implemented. This is going to be discussed for the first time in October. So you take a decision today for complying with the global sulfur cap, but your decision might affect your greenhouse gases positively or negatively, and this is something that's good to keep in mind. So I would like to say a few words about the greenhouse gas reduction strategy and maybe what to expect. What you see on this graph are global emissions from global CO2 emissions from international shipping. Starting at around 2005, they peaked in 2008, and they have they're a bit lower today, at maybe about 10% lower. And we have a few different lines here. This red line is what we call here the base business as usual scenario, which is how greenhouse gas emissions will increase in the future if we keep on building vessels as we were building them until now, and assuming a trade growth, then the emissions will go up. But the greenhouse gas strategy is asking to reduce emissions using 2008 as a base year, so we have to compare everything with 2008. And by 2030, we need to improve or to reduce our carbon intensity by 40%. That means compared to where emissions would be if we were doing nothing, we have to reduce them by 40%. And by 2050, we have to reduce our carbon intensity by 70%, and at the same time, our absolute emissions by 50%. Now, based on the assumption for the trade growth that I have here, these two targets in 2050, they fall almost on top of each other. But depending on how strong is the trade growth, we might need to take more aggressive or less aggressive measures to reach this 50% absolute reduction. And this we will not know until sometime after 2030. And that's also one reason, not the only reason, but this period up to 2050 now, it's split in three. We have short-term measures that are going to be discussed, as I said, in October for the first time. And maybe the one that we should expect for sure is stricter EDI requirements in the period 2023. And then we'll have mid-term measures up to 2030 and long-term measures on the way to 2050. And it's also important to remember that in 2023 this strategy will be revised based on the knowledge we have collected up to that time based on the IMO data collection system. So that's one part of the equation, that's the long-term part that is actually many people are really not thinking about this yet, I think, in detail. They know it's happening, but this is the immediate concern, the global sulfur cap. And what are the options here? Maybe roughly we can say that we have four options for compliance. One is to use gas oil or distillate fuels with 0.1% sulfur. Or you can install a scrubber and start using HFO, continue using HFO, excuse me. Or you can start using the new compliant blended fuels that will appear in the market. They will start appearing towards the end of this year. And there are actually some challenges associated with these fuels. And of course, another solution is to go for a completely different fuel. For example, it could be LNG, it could be LPG, it could be methanol, it could be batteries or even hydrogen. But in the short term, I don't think many of those will be used. LNG is the only one that we see having a little bit of a market share, but it's still quite small compared to all the other options. But really, there is not a single solution. As I said earlier, every vessel, every operating pattern will require a different solution. So this has to be a case-by-case investigation. Now, what is going to be the mix of these fuels in 2020? There are many uncertainties here. One uncertainty for some people is there going to be gas oil available or distillates available? Another question is, are there going to be blended fuels available? At what quantities? And are we going to be able to use them without problems? And another problem for those that are interested in scrubbers is HFO going to be available in ports? We know there will be a lot of HFO available from the refineries because it's a byproduct of several refineries. But because of low fuel demand, low HFO demand, it might not be available in every single port. What we saw in this graph, the first column is the fuel mix in back in 2012, and roughly 80% of the fuel was HFO and 20% was distillates or gas oil. In 2020, we have a few different studies here trying to estimate what is going to be the fuel mix. Dark blue is HFO, gray is blended fuels, 0.5% sulfur, and light blue is gas oil or distillates. And as you see, these studies, they don't really agree with each other, but they also a small share of HFO, and then they split somehow the rest of the consumption between blended fuels and gas oil. What we know today is that we're not going to have as many scrubbers as assumed a few years ago. And so this projection here by Shell is probably the most correct one in terms of HFO demand in 2020. I don't know what the exact number is going to be, but it's going to be lower than 1 million barrels per day. And the rest will have to be covered by the other fuels. Now, especially with blended fuels, there are several challenges. One is what is going to be their long-term stability. And I think this can probably be solved because the providers will, it's in their interest to provide products that are going to be stable. But there is a more serious issue, and this is the compatibility between different fuel batches. Many oil majors, they cannot guarantee, I don't know if anyone is actually guaranteeing that if you buy fuel from the same company, but in Rotterdam and Singapore, it cannot be guaranteed that these fuels are going to be compatible. Hopefully that will happen, but I have not seen that yet. And that is going to create challenges with bunkering. So a bunkering strategy is going to be very important if you want to use these fuels, and selecting a fuel provider is also going to be very important. Another problem is that these fuels are not available in the market yet. We expect the first samples to be presented in October this year, and then more products should be available for testing and getting used to them later. So this, I think it's going to solve or to answer some questions. Now, another problem with these fuels is that they are not covered by the current ISO fuel standard, the 82.17. And this is a big concern for owners. So I would like to say a few things about what to expect from the IMO work in the next few months, and also from the ISO working group. That's going to be very important. So first of all, in July, we have the IMO Intersessional, where we're going to discuss enforcement and transition measures for the global sulfur cap. And submissions are already being made. So in July, at the IMO Intersessional, these measures are going to be discussed, and this is going to give some clarity over how this is going to be enforced and implemented. And we get many questions today as to how this is going to happen, because this will affect the strategy of many ship owners. Then we have another intersessional in October, right before the MEPC 73, where implementation of the greenhouse gas reduction strategy is going to be discussed. And that will be, I think, quite interesting as well. And then in the MEPC in October, first we'll have the adoption of the carriage ban of non-compliant fuels, which means that from March 1st, 2020, you're not allowed to get HFO as a fuel if you don't have a scrubber installed. And also decisions on enforcement transition measures for the global sulfur cap will be decided. And that will be based on the discussion that will happen at the intersessional in July. And then at the end, I have the ISO fuel standards working group. This group is actually working quite intensively now. They're meeting much more frequently than normal. They're currently focusing on understanding how they can measure or how they can test long-term stability and compatibility between fuels. And they have started a project that will be concluded in October to evaluate testing methodologies for stability and compatibility. So in October, we'll know more about these testing methodologies that then fuel labs can perform to help owners understand if they can mix different fuel batches. I think that's going to be very important work. One problem here is that because of the processes involved in creating ISO standards, there is no time to produce a new ISO standard before 2020. Probably it's going to be 2022 before a new one is published. And this is why next year they want to publish what is called the publicly available specification, which is going to be like a draft standard, so that people can use that when they buy fuel. What is DNVGL doing? We have just published a white paper on alternative fuels. It's called Assessment of Alternative Fuels and Technologies. I had a copy there to show you, but well, I had to move here. This is a copy, and I think you can pick up one. One thing to remember is that this was developed with the intention to provide some guidance over the next 5 to 10 years. The intention is not to tell you what is going to be the future fuel after 2030. The idea is to help explain what are the different fuel options today and what you can use. And what we include in this fuel, in this paper, is a number of fuels. We have HFO and MGO, so oil-based fuels. We have LNG, LPG, methanol, biofuels, and hydrogen. And then with technologies, we don't mean energy efficiency technologies in general, but we mean technologies that can help for propulsion. And this includes wind-assisted propulsion, batteries, and fuel cells. There are two versions of this paper that you can actually download. I think you'll get the slides, so you can download from this link. And there's a short version that's executive summary, that's 12 pages long, that gives you a nice overview of all this work. And then you have the long version, which is 40 pages long, I think. And in that long version, we actually go into each one of these fuels and technologies, and we have in a systematic way, we give information on price, infrastructure, regulations, availability, environmental impact, technology, CapEx, and OpEx. So this provides, I think, a good overview of these different options. And also we intend in the future to make this electronic and updated in a regular, every few months probably, as new information is coming in. And finally, I would like to say a few words about how you can use these fuels. We have the IGF code, which entered into force in January 2017, and that's very important. It's mandatory for all ships using gas and other low flash point fuels as fuel, with the exception of gas carriers. Right now, the IGF code has requirements for LNG or for natural gas, either in the form of LNG or CNG. But other fuels are not included, and there is work now ongoing for including methanol and fuel cells, but not hydrogen storage. So this is on the international regulation side. If you want to use something else, you can still use something else, but then you need to go through the alternative design approach. But from our side, from DNVGL side, we have in our rules more options. So we have rules for gas-fueled ships, for LNG. LFL is low flash point liquid fuels, and that was developed mainly with methanol in mind, but it can be used for other fuels as well. We have rules for fuel cells and for batteries. So we actually provide rules for all these options. And in addition to that, right now we're working on the rules for LPG.